This is a multiplayer session between Herman Hum and the Alaskan Biker, also known as Kevin. We decided to play one of the old Harpoon 2 scenarios that had been remade for the player's database and Harpoon 3. Kevin selected Battle for the Yellow Sea because he'd tried it before. I asked him to pick the sides because I've been involved with nearly every scenario in rewriting, remaking, or testing. So I figured it was best if he picked the sides and tell me and assign the players. We set up the session and check in with our obligatory communications check. I reposition the map windows, and I'll use the main map window because it's a fairly large area, and in order to see everything going on. I'll check our scenario information. There's a new Korean War, and the U.S. is sending a carrier into the Yellow Sea. As commander of the Chinese forces, I must attack and inflict significant damage on the American vessels. A United States supercarrier is a formidable force with a complete air group and escorts, capable of taking out small countries. The North Koreans are allied to me, but I have no control over their assets. My base up at Luda has a number 36 short-ranged J-7 and J-8 fighters, with missiles are only 10-mile range. At Shanghai, I have a number of H-6 Badger standoff bombers with ASM Silkworm. These have approximately 50-mile range, along with some fighter escorts. Once again, the escorts have very short range. My main flotilla of frigates and destroyers, accompanied by two missile corvette flotillas. One nuclear submarine in the center of the Yellow Sea, and two diesel electrics. Not very much when compared to a supercarrier battle group. It could be anywhere in the Yellow Sea, and we have no idea, and I'm only going after it with a few aircraft and two bases. Quite challenging. Showing the range rings, the missile strength for my corvettes and my main destroyer group is quite limited. They ordered me to stay in the north, but I think I'm going to charge southward and try to pin him and get in, deliver a quick strike as soon as possible. I'll use the fighters to try to provide a little bit of air cover for the ships. Once I can pinpoint, I'll try to deliver a coordinated strike with Shanghai. The fighters are up, and I have assigned them patrol positions. The North Koreans are reporting their movements, but are not under my control. I've decided to send off three fishbed as sacrificial lambs or scout units to try and pinpoint the enemy task group, or at least get an idea where he might be operating. The fishbeds head off and detect electronic radiation from the two ships. One is identified as the Frigate Underwood class, and the second, we'll rename it the Guided Missile Frigate, and the next one is a Ticonderoga class cruiser. The wedge is quite huge, the uncertainty zone is large, and we don't know exactly where it might be. And with such a large zone, I'm unable to launch a strike at it. I'll try to whittle it down some. It's quite distant from the surface groups, no matter where in the zone it might be. My two closest fish beds will try to close on the target. One is summarily shot down right away. I immediately put down a couple of reference points to mark this area. At least I have a general idea where he might be. The planes will dive down low and try to close and get a third fix on it. I've noted where one plane has shot and the second plane is shot down. Even a negative datum such as a destruction of my aircraft can prove useful. The third one, I don't see any point in throwing away a perfectly good aircraft for no possible benefit. She runs for her life. I will use a nav zone to mark the suspected position of the carrier battle group. Instead of using a ship nav zone, I'm going to use a submarine nav zone, simply because if I mark it with a ship nav zone, the other ships will not be able to enter the area. So I just mark it with a sub zone, because I don't expect subs to get into that or plot them into the area yet. The fighters are taking a position in front of the task group. They're not going to be much use with their short-range missiles. However, they could shoot down an unarmed reconnaissance aircraft if it was nearby. The fighter in the south has managed to escape. Now that I have a general operating area, suspected operating area for carrier battle group, I've redirected all the missile corvettes to close on it as fast as possible and go to flank speed. What I plan for, the carrier has been detected, admissions at least, still in a huge group, but I suspect it's in the southern area. What I'm going to do is I'm going to send all my aircraft after it. I think I may as well try it. I'll send the Badgers in with a fighter escort. I'm sending every single plane I have towards the target. If I can get the missiles close enough, I can force him to shoot them down and use up his limited supply of SAMs, hopefully. What I've done is I'm going to send the fishbed fighters in slightly ahead of the bombers. I am attempting to get them to draw the fire of the fighters. If the fighters are being sacrificed, the bombers, I have a higher cruise speed than the fighters, but I've told them to slow down so they match the same speed as the fighters. I hope my ruse works. From the north, I have sent fighters in, and they are also going to try to provide eyes for the group. If I can pinpoint even one ship, then I can transmit and attack that ship directly. Having such vague contacts is not useful and does not help me in targeting. Right now, I ordered the first Finback to climb and activate her radar. I'm trying to get the enemy to look northward while I come in behind him or to his flank. Look at me! Look at me! Kill me! Kill me! Trying to keep his attention towards the north. I'm giving plenty of targets and my aircraft are breaking up into individual planes to cover a wider area. I just eyeballed it. Other people might be timing and trying to calculate different launch times in order to coordinate a strike. I'm fairly lucky. I just had a gut feeling and the planes appear to be arriving at the same time. Missiles are inbound on their first planes. They're supersonic. We have no, it looks like it's a Phoenix by the actor radar sensing Homer. Immediately, I expect this one to be destroyed, so I order other aircraft to start climbing and radiating their radar. Stay dumb. Just a little while longer, please. I wonder if my enemy will tell me whether or not my tactic worked. Did I distract them? I've got the bombers coming in on the deck. Notice the range ring, and the fighters are all spreading out. I do not have a fix on the enemy yet. I may have to close and visually identify them, so I'm trying to present as wide an area as possible. As I lose more fighters, I order others to climb and replace them. If I can fix the enemy with radar, that's much better, as it has should have longer range. Not bad timing for just eyeballing it. Pucker factor, the enemy's already engaging. What, will I survive to release the missiles, or will he shoot me down blindly? Still not able to reduce the uncertainty zone. Oh, there it goes, just a little bit. Every little bit helps. And another fighter is ordered to climb and radiate. Missiles in the air. Vampire, vampire. And another fighter is destroyed. You're serving the purpose. They're distracting the enemy. Enemy fighter radar is now detected. Giving the enemy plenty of targets. Another fighter is destroyed. Come on, give me a fix. Lock it, lock it. In the south, a bomber's in. Oh, he just got a missile off before he was destroyed. Looks like the enemy may have seen through it and is attacking the bombers in the rear as. Oh, and we've locked him up, locked him up. Just immediately shown up. All the bombers immediately open and launch on the carrier. 14. Oh, about 20. So about 100 missiles, I'm hoping, are now targeted on the carrier. What a beautiful sight, hey? I'm going to mark the carrier as with a reference point in case we get lost. Now that the carrier has been pinpointed, there's no need to sacrifice the fighters. They've already done enough. I recall them to the base in case I need them at a future time. As well, the fighter screen, sacrificial fighter scream that I had before, is doing the same and returning to base. That must be quite an awesome sight from his perspective too. As soon as the last missile is fired, the bombers turn to flee at best speed possible. What an awesome wave of missiles. Surely this must be enough to destroy the enemy. The bombers start taking losses, but after they have already released their missiles. That's okay, as long as they're keeping the enemy occupied with their deaths. If they're shooting down bombers, then the missiles are not being engaged. At this point in time, the game is running quite slowly due to the huge number of missiles from both sides in the air. We've crashed it a couple of times, and my opponent was kicked out. I suggested that since the missiles are already in the air and anti-air defenses is automatic in A&W, I would just run this for 2 minutes and let the missile attack resolution resolve itself, and then we would restart the game. He agreed. So for the next 2 minutes, he'll just be watching missiles go in, this huge wave. My other option was to try and hit 3 separate ships as part of the victory condition. Since there's only since the carrier is already in range in 2, I obviously went after the biggest target. Hitting 3 ships might have been easier, because in order to fulfill the victory condition, I need to inflict 600 points of damage on the carrier. That's a lot of damage in this SAM intensive environment. More bombers are dying. With so many missiles in the air, certainly some must get through. The reason why my opponent is kicked off the server is due to the timing out. That with so much information needing to be sent over to his computer, the computer is unable to respond within 30 seconds. Even though both our connections are high speed, this has been reported to AGSI, who has refused to fix it. They have talked about increasing the timeout limit from 30 seconds to something else, or something that can be set by the players, which of course would be wonderful. However, they haven't done so. So even people with high-speed connections will find their computers timing out and overloaded with games that involve many units and missiles. When going up against a Ticonderoga-class cruiser, expect to lose most of the missiles and the aircraft. I continue to lose bombers. Big reason for the timing out and overload of the connection and computers is the uncertainty zones. Some of these uncertainty zones get huge, and with so many of them being tracked, this often is what causes a player to be kicked from the server. One of the manual ways of trying to reduce it is to drop contacts. By clicking on a contact and hitting the number 3 from the number pad, you can drop a contact so that you don't track it. If you pick it up again, then that will tax the system. However, if it isn't picked up again, then the game will run more smoothly because it's not tracking as many huge uncertainty zones. I keep my fingers crossed. Will this be enough to put them over 50%? Please let it be. My Badger bombers are being savaged and totally wiped out. It would be interesting to know whether my opponent was actually able to identify and classify the bombers apart from the fighters. If he did, he deliberately shot down the bombers instead of the fighters, then good shooting to him. I've now lost contact with all my missiles. It's in the hands of the gods. The enemy appears to still be making 29 knots, not the sign of a cripple. Certainly the speed is reduced from a potential maximum, but not enough. At this point, I'm going to stop the session, save it, and restart a new session after inviting Kevin back. The Forrestal is still radiating her systems, so she's not sunk. What a great sacrifice for less than stellar results. It appears as though I'm going to have to commit the missile corvettes and destroyers and frigates. My single nuclear submarine will also attempt to make the interception. After rearming and reloading, the planes have been sitting, and once again I'm eyeballing where I think the enemy will be. My corvettes are racing ahead at 38 knots, while the slower missile frigates and destroyers follow at 26. As soon one frigate is immediate, corvette is destroyed. A second corvette immediately volleys her surface-to-surface missiles in an attempt to draw fire away. A destroyer, guided missile destroyer, is detected in range. She comes under attack by two frigates. A frigate, the guided missile frigate, is also detected, and I decide to send 8 missiles from 2 corvettes after her. I still have 2 ships worth. I'm just trying to decide whether I should attack the destroyer or the frigate. I'm trying to go for the 3 ship minimum victory condition. Missiles appear out of nowhere. I don't know if they're surface-to-air missiles or air-to-air missile defense, but they are very effective. Soon, most of my missiles are shot out of the air. I decide to attack the frigate and the destroyer with 4 more missiles each. This was a poor decision, as I will see later. Dividing your fire is the easiest way to lose a game. I should have concentrated on one, knowing that the enemy air defenses were still active and potent. I've ordered all my planes in to try and distract and draw fire as well as pinpoint the enemy. Launched from both bases, I have sent them up intermittently on high and active radar. I'm trying to keep the enemy attention from focused on my approaching ships. They're offering themselves for destruction in order to protect their shipmates. They even managed to exact a few kills off an entire flight of Tomcats. That's a lot of Tomcats. In the end, my fighters are no match. Every single plane on the aircraft carrier, except for the Hawkeyes, is probably superior to the fighters, to my fighters. My planes have arrived just a little early, but they're serving their role well, drawing the missile fire and attention away from my ships. They're decimated. And the ships are still too far away. The enemy fighters circle like sharks, taking huge chunks out of my fighter air force. I can barely see them. A Spruance-class destroyer is pinpointed. As my fighters were whittled down to almost nothing, the destroyers are closing. My destroyers are providing, along with the fighters, are providing forward reconnaissance. As one by one, the fighters are shot out of the air. The frigate is once again detected. She is still active. Now the enemy has turned his attention towards my missile corvettes. Even though their missiles are all gone, they are still serving a purpose by drawing the enemy missiles towards them. He's wasting wonderful harpoons that could have been used against my frigates and destroyers. Their sacrifice, hopefully, will not be in vain. So close, so close. The fighters continue to die, but the ships they are masking are getting into range. A major error on my part, I moved the ships as a group, and as a group, the maximum speed is 26. I didn't realize until now that some of the ships could have been making 31 knots, so now I've detached them, and they are speeding ahead of the others. My last fighter is circling, desperately trying to survive. Now she moves to try and pinpoint an enemy. And she's summarily executed. I still have two missile corvettes. They no longer have any respectable weapons, but their radar systems are their weapons. If they can pinpoint an enemy target, then the ships following up behind can launch from maximum range. Otherwise, they would have to close and locate targets for themselves. The guided missile destroyer Fife is in range, or has been detected, and they have a fairly good idea where she is, but she's still out of range. The frigate, guided missile frigate, appears to be dead. She's dead in the water, and her systems are silent. Is she playing possum? Is she simply lost power? She's alive! The systems are still up, even though she's not moving. Maybe she's just lost power and is dead in the water. Either way, she does not qualify as a kill. We have three possible targets: the Tycho-class cruiser, the Fife guided missile destroyer, and the guided missile frigate, as well as the carrier. What should I aim for? Try to get three, or go for the crown jewel of the Pacific Fleet? I decide, the frigate has a maximum range of 4 nautical miles for her gun, so I'm going to stay away from her. My most valuable purpose at this time for the missile corvettes is to keep an eye on the enemy. If I can maintain contact, the follow-up cruisers, destroyers and frigates can fire from maximum range. But I have to get out of range. The Fife is already in range. She has approximately 9-mile range of her gun, and we're only 7 miles away. I need to get out of here fast. I decide I'm going after the carrier instead of the three smaller ships. Why? Because that's what my command authority would want, even though I could win by maybe going after the three ships. They're in range, and I decide to send all my missiles, long-range missiles, after the carrier. Will some get through? The carrier must have spent another number of SAMs shooting down the silkworm, right? Obviously. Go for the carrier. This is another mistake I made. The enemy air defenses are still potent. My missile corvettes are finally destroyed, but they sucked up the enemy harpoons. The missile barrage I had planned is swept aside as though it was made of paper mache. What a waste. The ships now move in for gunfire. I still have some missile armed ships, but they're shorter ranged. My corvettes, my destroyers and frigates race in, knowing that they'll probably be destroyed soon. But they want to take some of the enemy with them. If they can get close enough, they could pull this off. The frigate is now within range. The leading destroyer frigate activates her radar to pinpoint it. Immediately, a large number of air contacts are also detected. We're not falling for this ruse. The radar systems were active. Now we're going to pound this frigate into dust. She's hammered mercilessly. Is she dead? Her system seemed offline, but she'd done that before. A flight of intruders or prowlers is coming. There's a flight of four. They're in within gun range and they're brought under fire. One down. Some revenge, as every single gun that comes to bear is turned towards them and opens fire. We fill the air with lead. They turn out to be prowlers. And all four shot down. Vengeance! We continue to pound the little frigate. I want to make absolutely sure. Until I see an explosion, we hit her. The enemy appears to be forming up an airstrike, and missiles are inbound. Hits! And one frigate is sunk. More missiles are inbound. The gunners fight desperately, trying to get into range. They take damage and are slowed down, but the enemy is only making 3 knots. With a 20 knot or so greater, I think we should be able to catch them. More enemy aircraft are detected, and we shoot them down by gunfire. I want that carrier. A Hornet is returning to base. The destroyers are ever so close, and another barrage of missiles is detected! The Jidan dies. Along with the Xian. She can barely move. And she sunk by the last missile. I only have 3 frigates left, but they press on and catch the carrier. I'm going to try to hold fire on my surface-to-surface missiles until I get closer. That way I can reduce the number of engagements the enemy might have. He's only making 5 knots, and I'm still doing 26. So, 21 knot at speed advantage. Inbound missiles! Inbound missiles! Harpoons! Alright, use them or lose them. I'm going to try and send them towards the carrier. With the enemy air defenses this powerful, I don't expect much success. The enemy brushes them aside once again. Just blast them out of the air. That's a lot of SAMs. In return, I lose 1 frigate. My last 2 survivors throw themselves at the enemy, but the Yibin wanders into range of the guns from the cruiser. The last frigate, Jiangdong, is going to try to attack from the flank. The enemy still has not sped up. She's in range, and she's trying to fire, and the enemy has pounded her into dust. She's only making 3 knots now. There's no way. She should be firing, but obviously the rounding of the gun range is off, so she cannot fire, and she is sunk. I still have 1 submarine. My nuclear-powered submarine is trying to catch the carrier. Unfortunately, she's been forced onto some shallow water and put her periscope up. The enemy knows he's there, and he's taken off at 20 knots, 29 knots. There's no way my submarine can catch him. By coming up to periscope depth and revealing himself, my submarine is easily destroyed. With no assets remaining, I concede the game to my enemy. I failed to achieve my victory conditions. I did manage to inflict damage, but I'm disappointed with my results. A great game, Alaskan Biker. Congratulations on the victory.